Well, praise the Lord. It's 7:50. We're going to start our services right now. Shall we all stand up on our feet? And let us just start this service today by reciting the Apostles' Creed, which I'm going to put up on the screen for you. So let's recite it together starting now. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Come, let us pray. Hallelujah. Father, we just want to, Lord, leave today's service in your hands. Father, once again, we thank you for giving us this beautiful place that we can come and worship and praise you and to listen to the preaching of your word. And Lord, as we come together this day, we pray, O God, that your Spirit of God will come upon us and prepare our hearts, O God, to receive everything that you have in store for us. So, Lord, we thank you. We praise you. We know that we are going to have a great time here in your presence. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone say, amen. Amen. We're going to have a time of praise and worship. So let's just start by giving the Lord a big hand. Amen.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I
my strength, my source of strength, my refuge. Oh, with you all things are possible. With you all things are good. For anything, but in all things, God, we will pray, and our prayer and supplications will make our requests made known to you, because we know, God, you're a good God, and you will hear our prayers.
Hallelujah. Thank you, O Lord Jesus. That we are, as we sing this song this evening, once again reminded that it's not by ourselves, our might, our merit, but by you that we can come to the end of our race, to know that, God, we have eternal life because of what Jesus has done for us. And even today as we sing this song, and maybe we carry burdens in our hearts and anxiety or worries about certain things, maybe something that's coming up in the future that we are concerned about, let's just take a moment to come before God and just trust in Him. When God brought Israel out of Egypt, every day He rained down manna from heaven. Not because of what Israel has done, not because of their faith, but it was God, because He's a good Father who provides. And so today as we come, let's be reminded that God is the one who loved us and sent His Son, Jesus, to come for us, to live His life, the Word becoming flesh and dwelt among us, that we can behold His glory, full of grace and truth. It was Him who went to the cross for your sin and for my sin, for Israel's sin. And it was Him who died and rose again for us, for our salvation. So Father, we just commit our church, our lives, our family, our career, our work, our family, whatever, Lord, that we are concerned about today, that we know, oh God, that You are trustworthy. You are faithful. If we are faithless, You remain faithful. You cannot deny Yourself. So help us, O God, and minister to us today through Your presence and through Your Word. And once again, strengthen us and encourage us. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone say, Amen, Amen. Let's give the Lord a big hand today. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Thank you, musicians and song leaders. Thank you. Please be seated down. Praise God. Today we have Pastor Jimmy that will be sharing God's word. But before he comes up, I just want to make just four very quick announcements. And the first announcement has got to do with this coming first weekend of April, which is our Easter weekend. Just thought I let everyone know early that we will just continue our Saturday night service at 7:15 p.m. here in this place. Okay, so there will not be any change to the service time. We're not doing it on Good Friday, neither are we doing it on Easter morning. Okay, so the rest, because basically this hall is used by Emmanuel Assembly of God. This is their church, and we are very thankful that they allow us to use for the Saturday evening time slot. Okay, now, but there's one important thing, and that is that day itself, Saturday, on the 3rd of April, in the morning, whoever that is available, it's going to be a small-scale community outreach. One of the reasons why I'm giving an announcement is to tell you that if you are interested to be involved, we're just going to go to some HDB blocks, distribute some food, visit some of the elderly there. It is organized by a community center. I mean, basically an outreach VWO. We are just participating in what they have organized. If you are interested, you just let me know. One of the reasons is that in the weekday, I gave you a announcement on the new ministry recruitment app. You know, a link or a QR code. Is we will approach those who indicate that they are interested in community work or charity work. We will approach them first. Okay, this ministry volunteer recruitment, right? I do not want you to be too worried, okay? You can actually just indicate, and even if you just can help out once a month, it's really fine. We just want to get more people involved, primarily also for you to get an opportunity to get to know other people in the church, okay? So it's not a heavy commitment thing. I want to encourage you to just indicate which ministry you're open to serve in, whether English service, Chinese service, children's ministry as well. We will contact you once we have the information. Then one more thing is our app, CGF app, right? We are doing it in this way where the default is that you are not coming. And then if you are going to come for service that week, please go into the app or go into the link and click I'm coming. So that way, our counter, okay, because every zone only allows 50 people, then we are able to monitor how many available seats are there. Okay, so last week and then this week, we still have available seats, but I'm thinking as we approach April, maybe Easter period, there may be more people coming. So I thought maybe we should start having this habit to go into the app early and then just book and say that I'm coming. Okay, so let's do that from this week onwards. And last but not least is that we have the offering boxes at the back of the hall. You can drop your offerings or you can give it through all the various channels and avenues. Okay, God bless you. Thank you.
Thank you, Pastor Tan. Well, I'm going to share the Word of God with you today. So please take out your Bibles and turn with me to the book of Micah. I'm going to continue on the book of the 12. And the next two books in the sequence of the book of the 12 are the books of Micah and Nahum. Okay? The books of Micah and Nahum. Now, we have learned over the last few messages that I was sharing that the three main message of the standard prophets are the call to repentance, judgment if the people don't repent, and then even after judgment, there's always hope. And in the next few books, as we go into the standard prophets, it will still be the same messages, all right? It does not change. The 12, the book of the 12, if it's a standard prophet, they will always be moving around these three main messages. But as I was preparing this week's message, I was thinking, I think you have heard four times about the three main messages of call to repentance, judgment if there's no repentance, as well as hope beyond judgment. So I'm not going to keep hammering the nail on the head again and again and again, all right? But what I'm going to do is that over the next few books, I'm going to share briefly on the context of each book, and then I will borrow the principles of those books to share on some lessons, some reminders, and some thoughts that I believe is important to all of us. All right? So let's now go to the book of Micah, all right? Micah chapter 1, verse 1, it says, "The word of the Lord that came to Micah of Moresheth in the days of Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah, which he saw concerning Samaria and Jerusalem." Now, Micah is a standard prophet. Now, every time when you read the book of the prophets, be it the major or the minor prophets, when they say it's a standard prophet, they preach the same three messages, all right? And Micah is also a contemporary, a peer of Hosea and Isaiah. So if you have read the book of Micah and you read the book of Isaiah, you put them together, you realize that there's some similarities between the way they write. Okay, scholars attribute this fact to the point that both Micah and Isaiah grew up in a place that is near each other. All right, so that could be the reasons why their writing is similar. Now, Micah prophesied from about 735 to 715 BC, before and after Samaria fell to the Assyrian Empire in 722. Now, during this period is a time when Judah, the nation of Judah, ascended to the heights. That means that they have gone to the glorious time, and also the time in one generation they will fall to the pits. Okay, so you can see that during the reigns of the different kings. During the reign of Jotham, he's a good king. 2 Kings chapter 15, verse 32 to 34, for your reference, it says that Judah prospered. They did very well under the reign of Jotham. But then the next king, Ahaz, 2 Kings 16, verse 1 to 4, they dropped to the pits as they went back into idolatry. They did everything in disobedience to the Lord. And then after Ahaz, the next king, Hezekiah, a very familiar king, we all know that he's a good king. 2 Kings chapter 18, verse 1 to 7. So you realize that when Micah prophesied to Judah, during this time, the lives of the Judeans was like this, up and down, glorious, down in the pits, up again, down again. And indeed, all of his prophecies from the book of Micah covered a full spectrum, transiting frequently between messages of utter despair to those of joyful hope and a promise of restoration. Now, let me give you examples, okay? Micah 1 verse 6, the invasion of Shalmaneser and Sennacherib. All right, it says here, "Therefore, I will make Samaria a heap in the open country, a place for planting vineyards, and I will pour down her stones into the valley and uncover her foundations." The destruction, all right, of the nation in Micah 1 6. And then in Micah 2 verse 12, it's the deliverance of Israel. "Surely I will assemble all of you, O Jacob. I will gather the remnants of Israel. I will set them together like sheep in a fold, like a flock in its pasture, a noisy multitude of men." So you see, in chapter 1, they were destroyed. In chapter 2, what happened? They were delivered. But then you go on in chapter 3. Again, the destruction of Jerusalem. Micah 3 verse 12. Okay, turn to your Bibles. Micah 3 and verse 12. Sorry, I thought that it was on the screen. But all right, Micah 3 verse 12. "Therefore, because of you, Zion shall be plowed as a field, Jerusalem shall become a heap of ruins, and the mountains of the wood, a wooded height." So once again, you see, they were what? They were at the pits. And then they were delivered in chapter 2. Then in chapter 3, once again, they were destroyed. And then in chapter 4, Micah chapter 4, okay, verse 10, can you please turn to Micah 4 and verse 10 and look at it? And it says in the second part of verse 10, "There you shall be rescued. There the Lord will redeem you from the hands of your enemies." So if you read the entire book of Micah, you will see again and again this sawtooth movement, all right? Bottom, top, bottom, top, bottom, top. Now we can see that there is a constant transition between doom and despair and hope and restoration. And therein lies the first question I will ask, the first of many questions I will ask today. Okay, today when I ask questions, I don't require you all to respond, but I just want to ask for you all to think. The first question is this kind of sawtooth movement a reflection of our journey as a Christian? Is this sawtooth movement a reflection of our journey as a Christian? You see, I believe that we can see a hint in the first coming of Jesus. And when Jesus came, before Jesus came, the children of Israel, they were suffering, they were in despair under Roman rule. And then Jesus came. And when they saw Jesus, they thought that he's going to be the next king, the king who's going to deliver them. They went from bottom all the way to the top. And then what happened? We fast forward, Jesus was crucified. All right? And then the disciples were all scattered. They went back to the pits again. And then 3 days later, what happened? Jesus resurrected and they came back up again. You can see a hint in the life of Jesus. And herein, I think, is the lesson that we can pick up from the book of Micah. The path of a believer is not a linear path. Okay, a Christian's life, where a lot of Christians like to use this cliche, from faith to faith, from glory to glory. Now, perhaps this is not the type of from faith to faith, from glory to glory that we are accustomed to. You know, sometimes, years ago when I was in full-time ministry, sometimes when people say, oh, how many people do you have for that meeting? Oh, I have 500. Wow, from faith to faith, because your last time was 499. All right, from glory to glory. Oh, what car are you driving now? Oh, last time it's a Lao Pok car. Now it's a car with an M, Maserati. Wow, from glory to glory. I don't think the Christian life is this kind of faith to faith, from glory to glory. From the faith of healing from a flu to healing from blindness. You know, many, many years ago, I was in a healing crusade in a Singapore Indoor Stadium. All right, I was a student of a Bible school, and then I was part of the person praying. I'm supposed to pray for sick people. All right, so I'm full of faith and power, correct? So I was standing there. So they said, oh, all the sick people come out, and then all of us are supposed to go and grab some sick people. Can I tell you, I don't speak for every single worker there, but I think, at the back of their mind, when they go forth and get people, they're all like, oh, please, tolong. You know why? They don't go towards those. It's just me. As I was walking down the masses of people coming from, I was looking for people wu guan tuan zhen, people who looks fine. So I saw this guy who looks fine. I went to him and his friend said, yeah, thank you very much for praying for him. He is blind. Of course, obviously, I prayed for him and nothing happened, right? So it's not about, oh, yeah, yesterday I prayed for someone, he got healed from the flu. Today I prayed for that person. Woohoo! The person, he was blind, but now he sees. Faith to faith. Or from the glory of having an apartment with water view, canal, to a penthouse with sea view, from glory to glory. I actually really think that a Christian life is not a linear graph. Perhaps a Christian life is more like this, a sine graph, but with an upward trajectory, with peaks and with troughs, but always going up bit by bit by bit. Let me give you an illustration. In 1997, I was healed on my left hand. I had 5% disability. I was in Pastor Tan's cell group, and I was telling my cell group helper at that time, I said, I want to play guitar for the cell group, but I can't because I have a disability in my left hand. You know, when I was in the Singapore Armed Forces, they liked me so much, they gave me quite a number of parting gifts, and one of it is 5% disability on my left hand. So when I can play all the normal chords, C, A minor, F, and a God's Jam. Because when I do this, my finger can't change after that. So can you imagine if you are the worship leader, right? C, A minor, F, 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 G, C, A, F, F. So I told my cell group helper, I said, I would like to play guitar one day. And he said, you pray to God to heal you. In 97, I did that, and my hand was healed. All right, so if ever, in a very unlikely reason, one day you see me playing guitar here, don't worry, it won't be F, 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 F. So it was great. God healed me. In 1999, I was healed of an incurable eye disease. All right, praise the Lord, God healed me. But since 2006, already quite a number of you know, I've been living with deafness, partial deafness on my left ear. I'm deaf in my left ear because of an accident. And I'm still not healed. So perhaps to go from faith to faith is to go from faith in God's healing to faith in God's grace to live with whatever condition that we have. Now, please don't misunderstand me. I wholeheartedly believe in supernatural healing. But I've also learned through personal experience that it is easier to have faith that God can heal you than to have faith that God's grace is sufficient for you. Every day since 2006, I wake up. The first thing I open my eyes, the ringing comes back into my ear. And I will gauge, it becomes subconscious. I will gauge, is it louder today or is it normal? Because if it's louder, it's a bad sign. That means that I have onset of vertigo, which is what happened 3 weeks ago when I stood here and don't know what I talked about. You know, some of you say, oh, wow. Some of you were very, very, very kind, okay? The Spirit of the Lord has come upon you when you text me and say, wow, great message. I don't remember anything. Okay, I was just in a haze. I was fuzzy. So every day I could wake up and believe that the grace of God is enough. That day it will be a normal day for me. And I think that I require more faith for that. So from faith to faith, it's not about just healing. It's also about that if the healing is not yet, then God's grace is sufficient. From faith to faith. Perhaps a believer's life of going from glory to glory is not about upward mobility in life. It's not about upward mobility in life or about progression in ministry. But perhaps going from glory to glory is about the glory of God bringing us through each and every challenge in life with just Him and no one else. Maybe it was such that last time we needed God to help us plus something else. Maybe we had nothing. And then God sent someone to give us something. You know, I was sharing this with someone the other day. I said that I'm not really worried about sound system because God has blessed me with a very loud voice. Then one day, it is true, I really have a very loud voice. Okay, for the sake of you watching on internet, it is true, I have a really loud voice. So there was once I was in a mission field and everything shut down because there was a power trip. And then the host church was really nervous. They were running around trying to reset the thing. And me and the 3-4 of us on stage, we said, never mind, let us just do whatever we have. So we sang without, you know, we sang without sound, without music coming out and everything. And that was the best service ever. And it set me thinking, this is where the glory of God is. That when we have nothing, but we only have God. Perhaps moving from glory to glory is that. That's why Micah chapter 7 verse 7 says, but as for me, I will look to the Lord. I will wait for the God of my salvation. My God will hear me. Church, always look unto the Lord. Not look at the results. Always look unto the Lord. Now, let's go on in the book of Micah. The book of Micah also provides one of the most significant prophecies of Jesus' birth in the Old Testament. It speaks of Christ's birthplace of Bethlehem 700 years before his eternal nature. You know, Micah 5 verse 2, I put it up on the screen for you. But you, O Bethlehem Ephrathah, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler in Israel, and whose coming forth is from the ancient days. Now, in this one verse alone, it prophesied about the coming of Jesus, where he's coming, and he told us about his nature, that he is a person with an eternal nature. You see in verse 2, it says, coming forth is from of old, from ancient days. All right? Now, the book of Micah also contains a very hopeful and encouraging passage about the world after Jesus returns. It's in Micah 4, verse 1 to 4. Now, we don't really have time to look at every single chapter, so you can go back and read about it. But I'm going to end the book of Micah today by giving a very important reminder from the Lord. And let me start with Micah chapter 3. Okay, let's turn to Micah chapter 3 and let's look at verse 9 to verse 11. It says here in verse 9, hear this, you heads of the house of Jacob and rulers of the house of Israel, who detest justice and make crooked all that is straight, who build Zion with blood and Jerusalem with iniquity. Its heads give judgment for a bribe, its priests teach for a price, its prophets practice divination for money. Yet they lean on the Lord and say, is not the Lord in the midst of us? No disaster shall come upon us. Now, these few verses show us that the people during Micah's time, they were very secure in the things that they are doing in the temple. They are very secure in their religious spirituality and their false sense of righteousness. They think that by doing all these things, it will save them from punishment, from their sins. They even boasted about their relationship with God. You see here in verse 11, all right, the second part, they said, Is not the Lord in the midst of us? No disaster shall become us, before us. You see, they were carrying out all the sacrifices, they were observing all the temple rituals, and they think simply because they do this, their sins will be covered. But what did God say in Micah chapter 3, verse 12? Therefore, because of you, Zion shall be plowed as a field, Jerusalem shall become a heap of ruins, and the mountain of the house a wooded height. Micah 6, verse 2, can we turn to it? All right, Micah chapter 6 and verse 2. It says, hear you mountains, the indictment of the Lord, and you enduring the foundations of the earth. For the Lord has an indictment, which is a charge against his people, and he shall contend with Israel. Now, sometimes you read the word, from you read the Bible, right? Contend with Israel, what does it mean? It means, 他要跟你算账. Okay, God wants to 算账 with Israel. That means God is telling them, you don't think that you do all these things and everything is okay. No, I am going to 算账 with you. I am going to contend with you. And this is exactly what Jesus taught in the New Testament. Matthew 7 verse 21 to 23, I put it on the screen for you. Not everybody who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. And then verse 23, and I will declare to them, I never knew you, depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. See, the people during the time of Micah thought that because they were carrying out all the religious rites, they were observing the rituals, they were giving sacrifices, then therefore God can cover every wrong thing that they are doing. They are wrong. Christ Gospel Fellowship, I need to tell you, coming to church is not a get out of jail card. Every week I come to church. Why? Because the whole week, Monday to Friday, I have been a demon. But now I come and I walk out a saint. And then next week, don't worry, I'll come and I will regenerate as a saint again. It does not work like that. Eventually, one day, God will contend with us. 跟我们算账. Okay? It's like that. Now, and even after God charged them, what did they say? Micah 6, verse 6 to 7, all right? Look into your Bible. Micah 6, verse 6 to 7, it says, with what shall I come before the Lord? This is the children of Israel talking, the nation of Judah. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offering, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? When they ask this, they are not coming before God and say, so God, what should we do? Should we come before you with burnt offerings, with calves, with rams? Shall I give you my children? It was not like that. The attitude that the children, the people of Judah came is, so God, tell me, I've already done all these things. What else do you want? What else must I do? Should I give you? So the way they say is, so should I give you cows? Should I give you rams? Or you what? You want my son? You want? Take. It was in this manner that they came before the Lord. And this is a reflection of how far they have fallen from God. Because they obviously thought that they can give their way into the favor of God. They thought they could. They were during this time, they were doing, like I said, they were like that, right? So they were doing well at certain times. But they thought that because they were doing well, they got money, they got thousands of rams and calves, 1 year, 10,000 rivers of oil. They even offer what is closest to them, their children. It all shows that they have fallen far from God because they obviously in their mind, they think that this is the way to gain the favor of God. And what did God remind them about? What did God answer them? Micah 6 verse 8, please look into your Bibles, all right? Very important verse. Micah 6 verse 8. He says, he has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly before your God. God used Micah to remind them, I don't need all these sacrifices because your heart is not right. What I need is for you to be kind, to love kindness, to do justice, to walk humbly before God. And this is my second part today. It is a reminder. The first one was a lesson from the book of Micah. The second is a reminder from the book of Micah that to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly, will require a heart that is turned towards God. To love, to do justice, to love kindness, to walk humbly, will require a heart that is turned towards God. You know why? Because there are some believers who will do unkind acts. They will speak unkind words. They will use sarcastic, cutting words. And then later they will laugh and they will say, oh, I didn't mean it. I just say only, 随便说说而已. Why are you so, you know, affected by it? Don't take it so personally. I only say. But you see, the issue here is the heart of the matter is usually the matter of the heart. You know, Bruce Walter and Leslie Hobb, right? Two scholars, they say, in the ancient world, the heart was the center for volition and the intellectual catalyst for feeling and action. It is always out of your heart. You know, I'm going to go into this today. I know it's a little bit sensitive, but can I tell you here, church in Christ Gospel Fellowship, that every word that you say, every action that you do, it comes from here. Oh, no, it's not. Yes, it is. It comes from here. So be careful about what you say. The way you say it, ask yourself, are you a sarcastic person? Are you a person whose words are very cutting? Why? You have no eyes to see, man? Why must we talk like that? You know, sometimes we will joke, right? They will say, oh, wow, the most anointed man is in the room. We laugh, but some people are like, whoa! Many, many years ago, I was in a small meeting. And then that day, Pastor Tan is supposed to go. He didn't. So he sent me. So I told him, I said, cannot lah, why you send me? Then he came up with this illustration that I still remember to this day. He said, you see, you must go. And then you preach your heart out. And when it's a good meeting, you will have a notch on your belt. And then the next time, when you have a challenge, you go to another meeting, you're not sure, you look at your belt, there's one notch. You preach the meeting and you have a second notch. So I just, okay, lah, whatever, lah. You ask me notch, I go. Lah. I went. The host of the house came out, saw me. Oh, Pastor Jimmy. Drip, drip, drip. Throughout the entire meeting, he was seated directly behind another person. I couldn't see him. No matter how I try to make eye contact, I can't. He was seated. And so you can't tell me that, oh no, I only anyhow say only. I tell you, the words that you say, the actions that you do, if we say that we are a believer of Christ, it comes out from here. And your actions and your words will reflect who is inside here. Ezekiel 36, verse 26 to 27. I will give you a new heart, and a new spirit I will put within you. And I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules. Do you read this? God says, I will take out the heart of stone and put within you a heart of flesh and put my spirit so that you can walk in my statutes. You follow what I say here. And you be careful to obey my rules. What did God tell the children of Israel? Be kind. Take care of the orphans. Take care of the widows. Take care of those who are underprivileged. And it takes a heart turned towards God to do that. In the New Testament, Ephesians 4, verse 21 to 24. All right. Assuming that you have heard about him and were taught in him, I put it on the screen. As the truth is in Jesus, to put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires, and to be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Okay. And to put on the new self created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. This is what it means. So if we profess that we have Jesus in our hearts, oh, we have repented and we have turned towards God, then it must be seen in our actions. It must be seen in our actions. Likewise, if we are not kind with our words and our actions, perhaps it is time for us to check our hearts. my wife is that person that helps me to check. Sometimes when I am short-tempered for too long, she will say, you need to pray. Something wrong. She said, you need to pray. Enough. Just these few words is enough. But basically, the long version is, you need to pray. You have been unkind in your actions and in your words. That is not a reflection of Christ in you. So since you are like that, that means that inside is not Christ, it's you only. Go and pray. But it is the truth. It is the truth. If our words and our actions are not like what Christ said, kind, humble, love people, love those who are underprivileged, do justice, then perhaps there's too much of us in here. Take a look inside. Who is on the throne in your heart? Is it you or is it Jesus? So it's a reminder from Micah that justice, kindness, humility flows out of our hearts. So I would like to end the book of Micah by telling all of us here, please let us make a daily decision to have a heart that is turned towards God every single day. Every single day, all right? Now, let's go on to the book of Nahum, okay? I actually have a video, but I don't have time for the video. You will see it another time, all right? The book of Nahum. Okay, Nahum is one of the four non-standard prophets, Daniel, Obadiah, Jonah being the other three. So therefore, because they are non-standard, they do not preach the three main messages of repentance, judgment, and hope. And instead, they preach different messages to the pagan nations. So the book of Nahum is likened to a continuation of Jonah, which I shared the previous time I was sharing, right? Because he also preached against the same group of people, which are the Ninevites, but about 150 years later. So Jonah came, right? We talked about Jonah, the book of Jonah, and how we should not be, this one I can remember, how we should not be so taken away by the arguments about the fish, whether is it a whale, a leviathan, or is it whatever, whether the human can survive in the digestive system or such a thing. It's not biology, right? It's about God's grace that forgave the people of Nineveh. Now, Nahum is a continuation, part two, because it's also the Ninevites, all right? And just in case some of you left the last time thinking that, wow, this Jonah, jinjala, very, very, very terrible. You know, how can he be upset with God for forgiving the Ninevites? Because God forgives, man, everybody makes it. Everybody falls and everybody commits sins. Why is he so upset? Now, let me explain why. Okay, Jonah is upset that God forgave the Ninevites because he wants them to be judged by God. But why? Because we must understand, the Ninevites or the Assyrians, they are very, very cruel. They are a very cruel people. They have a nickname. Their nickname is called the Lords of Torture. The Lords of Torture. What would they do? When they conquer a land, when they conquer a nation or a tribe, they will flay the kings. They will flay the kings. It's sport, ham, and the pee. They remove the skin of the king while the king is still alive. All right, they usually will only flay the arms and the legs because then the person won't die. And they will take the skin and they will put it on the walls of the city. Okay? And then they will cut off the limbs and gouge out the eyes of the general public, but they'll make sure that they do it in a way that they won't die. So that throughout the entire city or the town, you will always have people who are handicapped and blind walking around to remind them who is the boss. To remind the population that, look, it's the Assyrians who are the boss. You better behave yourself. They will impale people through their stomach because they found that to impale, to put a stick through their stomach will cause them to die very slowly. They will throw children into fires. They will throw babies into fires, leaving babies into burning fires. I think you get the idea. The Assyrians, the Ninevites, this is how evil they are. That is why, can you imagine Jonah? Jonah is like, God, do you get the wrong person? You're supposed to forgive the Ninevites. Are you sure? Did the archangel give you the wrong name, the wrong tribe? Not the Ninevites, not the Ninevites, right? Ninevint. It's not the Ninevites, it's the Eightvites. It's the Tenvites, not the nine Ninevites, because they are so evil. And the fact is this, they repented. God forgave them. But even though they repented and God forgave them, in the book of Nahum, it tells us that the Assyrians reverted back within 150 years. 江山易改,本性难移. They went back, and this time when they went back, they were even more powerful, more cruel. If you go and read history, Christian history, they will tell you that during the time of Nahum, they have reached the peak of their evil, cruel nature. They have broken through. They have attained the nirvana of being evil. They have reached all the way to the top. Nahum 3, verse 2 to 3, is talking about the evil that they have done in all the nations that have conquered. The crack of the whip, the rumble of the wheels, the galloping horse and bounding chariots, horsemen charging, flashing swords and glittering spear, hosts of slain, heaps of corpse, dead bodies without end. They stumble over the bodies. They are talking about the moment the Ninevites go through a city, there is heaps of corpse. By the way, the Assyrian soldiers like to build pyramids of decapitated heads. They just like it. So this is what they have become within the 150 years after God has forgiven them. And therefore, when Nahum came and prophesied about the impending destruction of Nineveh, which is of Assyria, you can imagine the people of Judah. Because every single day they are living under this kind of torture. But then Nahum came and told the Ninevites, I've forgiven you once, but you're still doing this. I will judge you. I will destroy you from the face of the earth. Can you imagine the nation of Judah? Hang on. So how many people can live like this any longer? Nahum 1:7 says, the Lord is good, a stronghold in the day of trouble. He knows those who take refuge in him. So the main theme of the entire book of Nahum is that while he allows the enemies of the children of Israel to take them captive because it's judgment for their sinful acts, evil does not triumph forever. And God will always provide a way back and restore those who turn to him. All right, let's look at Nahum chapter 2 and verse 2. Just a few more verses, okay, in the book of Nahum. Nahum chapter 2, verse 2, for the Lord is restoring the majesty of Jacob as the majesty of Israel, for plunderers have plundered them and ruined their branches. So you see here that the book of Nahum, God speaks very clearly about the wrath of God, about his wrath and his judgment. But he also speaks very clearly about his mercy, his character, how God is gracious, how he's slow to anger, how he's abounding in steadfast love. Nahum chapter 1 and verse 3. I put it up on the screen for you. Nahum chapter 1 and verse 3, it says, the Lord is slow to anger, great in power, and the Lord will by no means clear the guilty. So the entire book of Nahum, the theme is how God wants to judge the children of Israel, the nation of Judah, because of their sins. And he will allow them to be captured, to be tortured, to be enslaved, and to be destroyed. Not totally destroyed, but to be stepped upon by the enemies. But these enemies will still be judged by God. Okay? Now, at this point, I would like to borrow the message of Nahum. Again, like I said, I want to raise a thought for you to think about. Something for us to take away tonight as we go back later. All right? And I will start by asking you two questions. Number one, does God know that the Assyrians will turn back to evil? In the book of Jonah, it says that God wants to judge the Ninevites, but then they repented. Even the cows repented. Okay, even the cows repented. When the animals are repenting, it is real repentance. Okay? When God saw them repent, do you think that God, in his infinite wisdom and his infinite knowledge, understand his omniscience, he knows everything. Do you think that he knows that 150 years later they are going to do all these evil things again? Do you think that he knows? If the answer is yes, then the next question is, why then did he forgive them? If you already know that they are going to be evil again, then why forgive them? Why don't just solve the problem? Just get rid of them in the book of Jonah. Don't have to worry about it all over again, right? Now, let's look at what Jesus did. John chapter 13, verse 21 25 to 26. When Jesus had said these things, this is the Last Supper, he was troubled in spirit and testified and said, "Most assuredly, I say to you, one of you will betray me." Okay, Jesus knows that Judas is going to betray him. And then leaning back on Jesus' breast, he said to him, this is Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, who is it?" Jesus answered and said, "It is he to whom I shall give a piece of bread, and when I have dipped it, and having dipped the bread, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon." Now, we all know this, that Jesus knew that Judas is going to betray him. But yet, he sat Judas close to him. I think I shared this in one of the recorded messages during the circuit breaker, that Jesus sat Judas close to him, okay? And he fed him, he dipped the bread and he fed him. Because feeding someone is a sign of affection. Jesus knew that Judas is going to betray him, but yet he still fed him. He still accepted him. Some commentaries will say that Jesus did this because probably he hoped in his heart that maybe Judas will change his mind. Maybe. He did this and he gave to him. But yet, Jesus also knew that he must die on the cross so that the scriptures can be fulfilled. So this is the thought that I'm going to leave with us today. Like I said, there's a lesson, there's a reminder, there's a thought. God, the thought is this: God does not judge us based on our future choices. God does not judge us based on our future choices, and he will forgive us of today's sin when we repent. When we commit a sin, we come before God, we confess, and we say, "Please, God, forgive me." God is not going to say, "Okay, I'm going to forgive you, but I have a caveat, okay? On condition that you sign this form and sompa, that from this day onwards, you will not sin again." Okay, God, I sompa, then you sign, "Okay, then I forgive you." It was not like that. God looks at us. You know, last time I used to like to do this, right? I used to like to ask, but please don't respond. I like to used to ask and say, "How many of you have seen in the last 24 hours? Please put our hands." And then, you know, there'll be some that didn't put our hands. Those that you that didn't put our hands, you just seen. Because it's the truth, in the last 24 hours, your thoughts, your words, your action, we surely have seen. But we know that when we come before the Lord in repentance, God will forgive us because this is in his nature. Joel 2 verse 13 says, "Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love, and he relents over disaster." In Jonah 4 2, it's almost a similar verse. So Nahum, Joel, Jonah, they all talk about this, how God is slow to anger, gracious, merciful, abounding in steadfast love. God will not judge us based on the decision we will make in the future, even if that decision is wrong. Now, some people will say, "Oh, then that means okay, I got a free pass to heaven, you know, I can do anything I want." Now, let me warn you. The book of Nahum shows that repentance is not the only step in our relationship with God. The Ninevites repented in the book of Jonah, but they took it for granted. At that time, they were very genuine. But later, they took it for granted and they sinned. And what happened? Eventually, they were destroyed. So never, ever underestimate the power of sin. Because there will always be a time, a point where you will cross and you can't turn back anymore. Let me give you two simple illustrations. Number one is gambling. All right, I think all of us would have seen Li Guo Huang, right, on one of the advertisements. 多一次就行, just one more bet. Give me money, one more bet. It's always one more bet. One bet, one more bet, one more bet, one more bet. And eventually a person is addicted to gambling and will eventually end up in debt. See, but when they are one more bet, they always think it is okay. But before they know it, they would have passed the point of no return. Now let's talk about marriage. You know, those of you who are married, don't say it's okay, one more look. Don't, I even hear this, "Oh, but God created us to appreciate beautiful things." So what is wrong, no? Yeah, but God created you to appreciate beautiful things, but you don't need to drool. Don't have this. One more of you, those of you who are married, and those of you who are going to be married next time, remember, don't have this one more look, because you have one more look, another look, another look, and then you all go out for lunch, you know, as in like, you all go out for lunch because you are colleagues or casual friends, right? Then you all will go, but you see, go, walk, then the hand will brush. And eventually what happens? We all know what happens. Now, many years ago, when I was counseling a guy, all right? He had an affair. So I said, why, brother, why? Do you know what he said? He said, I mean, some of you think that I'm funny. You haven't seen me angry yet. He said, oh, pastor, it just happened. Oh, man, when he said that it just happened, boom, I changed my name. I'm no longer Jimmy. I'm Sons of Thunder. I said, it just happened. You say it just happened. It just so happened that you look at her once, look at her twice, look at her many times. It just so happened that you go out for lunches so often. It just so happened that your hands brush against each other. It so happened that you hold each other's hand. It so happened that you both end up in the hotel. So happened you're on the bed and fornicated. It just so happened. What the person? I'm a bad counselor because I'm not supposed to do that. You know, I'm supposed to, it just happened. I'll write it down. Just. So how do you feel when it just happened? I'm supposed to do that. I spent a lot of money being trained to be a counselor and told me to do that. But I asked the person, how did it just happen? It didn't just happen. You make a decision every single time to look one more time, to go out, to have that electrifying thing, to somehow decide to go into a hotel and fornicate. It's a decision every step of the way. I told brother, it's a decision. And at every step, you could have turned back. But now you can't. You see, because sin is addictive. Sin is seductive. And there will always be a point of no return. So do not take God's grace for granted. Remember, God is good. When we make a daily decision to follow Jesus, to have a heart that is turned towards Him. When we make that decision, what's going to happen is we will still sin. I hope to tell you, can I musician on stage? I hope to tell you that when you make a daily decision, like what Pastor preached last week, we take up the cross, you know, and a lot of people say, I want to follow Christ. But after a while, you read the Bible, you realize, wow, it's not so easy to follow Christ, man. That's why it says, take up the cross. When we decide to take up the cross, life is not going to be a bed of roses. It's not going to be. We will still sin. We will still make mistakes. But as long as every time we step wrongly, we repent. And when I say we repent, it's not just in words. We repent with our actions. We repent with our attitude. Can I tell you this? Whether a person has repented or not, it can be seen. How clearly? As clear as night is from day. Don't need to say. Those of you who are parents, you know what I mean, right? When your kid does something wrong, there are two kinds of sorry. One sorry is you know they won't do it again. The other sorry is so that you stop scolding them. And they'll do it again the next available moment. Whether a person is truly repentant, it can be seen. But you see, if a person has God in him, has Christ in his heart, not himself, he will be truly repentant. And in his mind, he will always draw a line. And he will tell himself, I can't cross this. I cannot. And then the devil will speak, it's okay. I mean, come on, I did it so many times already. Right? You eat lunch 842 times already. Yeah? What is the 843rd? But he said, I can't. I just cannot. See, this is that line of no return. But that will require, you must know, when you stand here on the right side of the line, when you think like this, you say, no, I can't keep sinning because the grace of God one day may run out. Then you're on the right side. Every time you repent, you can trust and have faith in the nature and the character of God. He's good, He's gracious, He's kind, He loves you. But if you ever cross that, Micah 7, verse 18 to 20, I will leave you with a good verse. Who is a God like you, pardoning iniquity and passing over transgression for the remnant of his inheritance? He does not retain his anger forever because he delights in steadfast love. He will again has compassion on us. He will tread our iniquities underfoot. He will cast all our sins into the depths of the sea. You will show faithfulness to Jacob and steadfast love to Abraham as you have sworn to our fathers from the days of old. Christ Gospel Fellowship. The journey of a Christian, as much as we would like it to be linear, it is not. It's ups. It has its ups and downs. But God is with us every step of the way. Church, remember that our words, our actions will flow out of our heart. And if our heart is turned towards God, our words and our action will be reflective of God. We will be kind. We will be humble. We will be people who wants to do justice. We want to help. Friends, God will not judge us based on our future decision, even if that decision is wrong. Because God is a good God. This is in His nature and His character to be gracious and to be loving. But please, don't take His grace for granted. And I pray that all of us tonight will remember these lessons, this lesson, this reminder, this thought, and that we will check our heart and we will flee from sin. We'll be continually repentant and be transformed more into the likeness of Jesus Christ. Stand with me on your feet. Hallelujah. We're just going to end worship with worship and then we will pray. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
To this I hold, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and ever is my plea. Oh, the chains are released. I can see I am free, yet not I, but through Christ in me. With every breath, shall lift up your hands. With every breath, I long to follow Jesus, for He has said that He will bring me home. And day by day, I know He will renew me until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus, we come before you. Father, first and foremost, our heart is filled with overflowing. With once again a reminder from your word that you are a God who is gracious and merciful, full of loving kindness. That even though you know that some of us will sin again in the future, you still love, forgive, and embrace us now. And God, we are thankful. Lord, we know that our past sins have been washed away by the blood of Jesus. But in reading your word, we also know that our present sin will be washed away. And reading from your word, we know that you love us so much. You are so kind, so merciful, that it does not really, really bother you what our future decision will be. That, Lord, you look upon us from heaven, and you always look upon us with the eyes of a father, having faith in each and every one of us, believing in the good in each and every one of us. You know, Christ Gospel Fellowship, I just really feel that there are some of us here in this room tonight, and even those of us watching on the internet, there are some of us who always struggle with acceptance. You will repeat in your mind of the things that you have done, how you have sinned against God, how you have let Him down, and you wonder again and again, you struggle with the fact. When someone says God loves you and He forgives you, you struggle. But tonight, I hope the word of God will set you free. For as far as God is concerned, your past is dealt with. Your present is being dealt with. And your future only has one constant, and that is how God looks at the best of you always. Every single day when He looks at you, He only sees the best in you. Friends, you are valuable to Him. You are precious to Him. He sent His Son to die for each and every one of you. So receive this understanding, this realization that God is awesome, gracious, merciful. Hallelujah. Jesus, we come before you this evening and we say, Lord, you know that you are the one who created us. You know that we are created out of dust. Sometimes there are things that we want to do, but we end up not doing them. There are other things that we will not to do, but we end up doing them instead. But Lord, we put our lives in your hands once again. And we say, everything, Lord, everything is in you and is through you. So Jesus, come. Bring us through, walk with us in this journey, and let every one of us be that great reflection of who you are. We thank you, we praise you, in Jesus' name we pray, everyone say, amen. Let's give the Lord a big hand. Let's recite the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, and deliver from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine upon each and every one of you. And may the Lord manifest His grace to every one of you, that you will experience His grace in a very real way. And the Lord will lift his countenance upon you and give each and every one of you peace. And may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you. Amen. Amen. Let's give the Lord a big hand. Praise the Lord. Remember, God's character is such that he only sees the best in you. It does not matter to him what your decisions will be in the future. God loves every one of you. Go and be blessed. Have a great week ahead. Amen. God bless you.